7 Nightly News with Ross Simons.
At least 25 people killed in Australia's worst massacre. Kieran Perkins wins his ticket to Atlanta. And the former government defends its massive travel costs. Good evening. A siege is underway in the Tasmanian town of Port Arthur, where at least 25 people have been shot dead in Australia's worst massacre. Another 26 are wounded. The gunman is holding police at bay. He's believed to be holding at least one person hostage. Most of the victims are reported to be tourists visiting the historic penal colony at Port Arthur. And a warning that some of the pictures in this report may be disturbing.
Helicopters began ferrying the injured to Hobart from Port Arthur after a gunman opened fire there this afternoon.
We've had a gunman run amok on the Port Arthur historic site. That's 85 k's from Hobart. It happened mid-afternoon. There are at least 12 confirmed dead, if not 22. There's a further 15 injured, and at the moment we have a hostage and siege situation which we're attempting to contain the control.
The convict ruins are a favourite with interstate and overseas tourists. It's understood those visitors have made up the bulk of those killed or wounded. Locals near the site cringed in fear inside their shops and homes as the gunman opened fire.
Everyone's just freaked out.
What do you understand he may have done?
Kill lots of people.
Any idea why?
No idea.
Any idea who he was?
No idea. Not a local, I don't think.
Do you know if any tourists have been involved?
Yes, there have been.
It just sounds awful.
It is awful. It's very, very awful.
A few minutes ago, reports put the death toll at 25 dead. Some of those killed apparently incinerated in a car near the ruins. Another 15 people have been badly injured. It's understood the siege has now moved to a cottage on the site, the armed man apparently holding one, possibly more hostages. Police have surrounded the cottage as Special Operations Group officers continue negotiations. It's understood the gunman is a 22-year-old armed with a machine gun. What sparked the massacre isn't known at this stage. Special police hotlines have been set up for people who fear for the safety of relatives. The numbers are 002 302 519 or 002 302 516. Steve Kerry, 7 Nightly News.
Welcome to Sunrise, I'm Chris Barr.
And I'm Peter Ford. We'll cross to Hobart shortly and speak to 7 Network correspondent Adam Walters, who is at Royal Hobart Hospital.
And later we'll talk to some of the survivors of Sunday's massacre. But first up this morning, the man believed responsible for Australia's worst mass murder this century is sedated and under police guard in a hospital. Police say they expect to talk to him later this morning when charges can be laid.
The first of the names of those slaughtered at Port Arthur are being released. Among them, 55-year-old Mervyn Howard and his wife Mary from the tiny village of Dunstown near Ballarat in central Victoria. Well respected in the local community, they were avid churchgoers. He was the secretary of the Ballarat Football League for 14 years. They leave behind 5 children. Mervyn and Mary's killer lies under police guard in Royal Hobart Hospital, the same hospital in which many of his victims are still being treated. Shortly after lunch on Sunday, 28-year-old Martin Bryant systematically mowed down tourists at Port Arthur. 32 were dead by the time he reached the Seascape Guest Lodge, a bed and breakfast 5 kilometres north of the penal colony. Its 2 owners were held hostage, along with a 3rd man earlier forced into the boot of a BMW. The car was later set alight. The gunman, who was armed with several high-powered rifles, continued to shoot at police. They tried to negotiate with him until his phone battery ran out.
Our principle at the moment is to keep the house isolated and the people in it contained within the site. And we're hoping to open negotiations again. They've broken down because of some technical problems.
Special Operations Police surrounded the house, lying in wait until dawn. Then at 8 a.m, the seascape burst into flames.
The upstairs portion of it is on fire, and there are flames coming from partly down the on the lower level, on part of it. It's starting to slowly spread, I understand. There are still shots being fired, so at this stage I've given instructions that none of our personnel are to approach the house.
30 minutes after the blaze began, Martin Bryant fled the house, his clothes ablaze. He was arrested on the spot. His hostages could not escape the flames.
A person has been taken into police custody, conveyed to the Royal Hobart Hospital. suffering from burns, no gunshot wounds.
The killer was taken by ambulance to Hobart Hospital, under police guard and with his head covered. He'll appear in court as soon as doctors allow. Later in the day, police escorted media along the path of the rampage.
I think carnage is the simple way to describe it. It's probably the only single word that I know that would describe what was experienced in there.
The guest lodge still smouldered late into the day. Police have uncovered the remains of two of the hostages. They're still looking for the third. Their deaths bring to 35 the number killed. 18 were injured. 4 have been discharged. 5 people are now off the critical list. Sue Stevenson, 7 News.
Joining us now live from the Royal Hobart Hospital, 7 Network correspondent Adam Walters. Good morning, Adam.
Good morning, Peter.
What's Martin Bryant's condition this morning?
Well, he's believed to be serious but stable. He's been under constant watch overnight under that very tight police guard in an isolated wing of the hospital. There had been some concern from the relatives of his alleged victims that he was, in fact, in the same building. But hospital management tells us he's well away from the people still in hospital after the weekend shootings, and he's been undergoing assessment from psychologists and surgeons alike.
When are charges likely to be laid against him, Adam?
Well, police are very anxious to lay charges quickly because of all the publicity. They're very conscious of not jeopardising his chances of a fair trial, and that seems to have been dashed already here in Hobart. The local newspaper this morning, judge and jury already making up its mind. There's nothing ambiguous about this headline or the photo. Despite attempts yesterday to cover his head when he was admitted to the hospital, identification has already become a real legal issue and is causing police a great deal of concern. Now, they hope to charge him with at least 2 of the murders today so they can have him remanded in custody and get on with the huge task of preparing a brief for all 35 murders. Now, it's likely it will be a bedside court hearing that he will not be well enough to leave the hospital to appear in the Hobart court.
Adam, what do you hear about the survivors?
Well, the survivors, that report mentioned, a lot have been released. There were 5 on the critical list. They're yet to be interviewed by police. Among those to be spoken to by detectives, those who came face-to-face with the alleged gunman. With the dead outnumbering the survivors 2-1, there aren't many who can tell police exactly what happened at Port Arthur. Those who can have told of how they'll be haunted by their narrow escapes. Hobart woman Karen Jones said tourists thought the sound of gunfire was part of some historic reenactment at the infamous penal settlement.
It was just like a cannon going off. We thought it was all part of the show. We were going down to check out what was going on, you know. We thought it might have been a little bit of extra on the side, so... So, like, you get the tours around there, and we thought they were letting off cannons and...
Her boyfriend, Philip Milburn, says the shooting was not as random as initially reported.
I mean, if we walked past him and we went the other way and he went to the shop, I think, well, if he got out of the car and started shooting straight away, well, we might have been the first, maybe.
The shock of their encounter with the gunman was still setting in as they recounted the panic of the scramble to safety.
A pregnant lady, Karen, she was there. She just couldn't stop vomiting. She was sort of panicky. There was an old guy upstairs. He'd lost his wife. He couldn't find her, but they found her downstairs.
He just asked because he couldn't get downstairs. Too many people, and everyone sort of passed the message on. They found her.
So there would have been people in there who may have lost loved ones, who didn't know what had happened to their loved ones.
Among the others facing danger, helicopter pilots forced to fly through gunfire during the airlift of casualties.
Well, I was requested by the paramedic to fly as low as possible, which is not an unusual situation as we normally get involved in that type of accident or in people with chest injuries. We are used to that, and sometimes, luckily yesterday, the weather was not a problem. So we were able to comply with that request and we came all the way below 1,000 feet.
Hospital staff have been praised for the way they coped with the emergency, management denying rumours that some nurses refused to treat the gunman. Adam Walters, 7 News.
And Adam, what are we hearing about the counselling for the survivors and also their relatives?
Well, teams of counsellors have been flying in from interstate. That job is a mammoth task. Almost as big as the job that the police have at hand after a relentless weekend. The police have to interview 180 witnesses. That's going to take quite some time. I think after the court appearance today, it could be 3 weeks before we'll see him before a magistrate again.
Thanks, Adam. We'll come back to you later on in Sunrise. 7 Network correspondent Adam Walters joining us live from Royal Hobart Hospital.
The massacre has again renewed the debate over gun laws. Prime Minister John Howard says he'll push for a national gun register when he meets with federal and state police ministers next month.
These are the weapons of destruction that are all too easily available in Australia. The horror of the Port Arthur slaughter has prompted emotional pleas for tighter gun laws to control their use.
There is absolutely no right to bear arms in the community. There is a right to community safety, and we're seeing that right to safety completely disregarded while politicians cower in fear of what the gun lobby can do to their electoral hopes.
Prime Minister John Howard responded immediately, bringing forward a meeting of state and federal police ministers to Friday week to implement uniform national gun laws.
There is no legitimate interest served, in my view, by the free availability in this country of weapons of this kind.
While the federal government banned the import of semi-automatic weapons in 1991, one major stumbling block remains. The Commonwealth does not have the constitutional power to impose national gun laws on the states. But Mr. Howard says this time he won't brook any opposition.
I will not retreat an inch from the national responsibilities I have in relation to this whole issue, not an inch.
We've got to get it done and get it done in the right way.
And the signs today are that the states will finally fall into line.
I believe that the public of Australia are looking for urgent and immediate reaction.
A national response, a national approach, a national solution is required.
But the gun lobby is continuing to resist.
I have no problem with all the states having the same gun laws. What I do have a problem is with the government in Canberra trying to take control of those things which are, at the moment, the rights of the sovereign states.
In Canberra, Glenn Melne, 7 News.
Federal Parliament officially resumes today, and the man with the job of keeping MPs in line is Victorian Liberal Bob Halverson, the new Speaker of the House of Representatives. He defeated 5 other candidates for the job, including long-serving National Party MP Ian Sinclair.
The Liberal Party met yesterday on the eve of the official opening of the 38th Federal Parliament, and Victorian Liberal MP Bob Halverson is set to become its new Speaker after the party room gave him the nod over 5 other candidates. And he immediately promised to make the role more independent and said he would no longer attend party room meetings.
As you're probably aware, I have a reputation somewhat of a disciplinarian, but that only relates to unruly, derisory and demeaning behaviour.
While John Howard was at pains to remain aloof from the process, Mr Halverson is a close ally of the Prime Minister.
I am always happy with choices by the Liberal Party room.
The 5 other candidates included the longest-serving parliamentary MP, the National Party's Ian Sinclair. Other Liberal candidates included Neil Andrew, Lou Lieberman, Cathy Sullivan and the outspoken Wilson Tuckey. Today's opening of the Parliament will be a ceremonial occasion, but the government has signalled it will move quickly on the partial sale of Telstra and introduce the legislation later in the week. The government estimates the legislation will then come before the Senate in 3 weeks. Questions in Canberra, Helen McCabe, 7 News.
Police in Hobart are waiting on medical advice before they have further talks with the man believed to be responsible for Sunday's Port Arthur massacre. He's under guard in the Royal Hobart Hospital. Also at the hospital this morning, our reporter Adam Walters. Good morning, Adam, again.
Good morning, Chris.
Now, do we have any indication at all of what the alleged gunman is like?
Well, apparently he's been quite lucid and talking to police overnight. The extent to which detectives have interrogated him, for want of a better word, about the weekend shootings is not known at this stage, although police are very anxious to lay charges as soon as possible because of the widespread publicity the shootings have been attracting.
Do we know what police will be doing today?
Yes, they'll continue to interview witnesses, and that's proving to be a mammoth task. 180 witnesses to interview over all 35 murders. It's going to take some time. At this stage, we believe they're planning to charge him with at least 2 of the murders today, if they can, if his condition allows proceedings to go ahead. Now, if they can have him remanded in custody at what is likely to be a bedside court hearing, they'll then have at least 3 weeks to prepare a thorough brief on all 35 murders.
And just finally, some of his alleged victims are in the hospital with him. What's their condition this morning?
Well, that irony hasn't been lost on anybody, but the hospital management has been very anxious to assure relatives of the people still in the hospital that the alleged gunman is in an isolated wing of the hospital under a very tight police guard. They're watching his every movement just about. He's been under constant surveillance after the weekend's alleged activities, there's no way that he can be underestimated in terms of security. And I guess to an extent, the police are there to protect him. Emotions are running very high here in Hobart. It's really starting to sink in. At first, there was stunned disbelief. You can really feel the anger starting to boil.
All right, Adam, we'll leave it there. Thanks.
Okay.
Adam Walters reporting live from the Royal Hobart Hospital.
Police say the names of those 34 victims of the Port Arthur massacre may be released today. They have now determined the origins of all but six of the dead, including two Malaysians.
Slowly, details are emerging about Martin Bryant, the man arrested and being held in police custody in hospital. The picture taking shape is that of an introverted loner, prone to violent and unpredictable mood swings. His condition apparently worsened after he was badly injured in a car crash which claimed the life of the woman who'd taken him in and cared for him. Soon after that, Bryant's father committed suicide, and mental health experts are now suggesting this accelerated a downhill slide into a dark world that exploded in Port Arthur on Sunday.
Is it gunshots?
Of the 34 people Bryant is alleged to have gunned down, 12 were from Victoria, 9 from Tasmania, 4 were from New South Wales, 1 from South Australia, and there were 2 visitors from Malaysia. A third Asian man of Indian appearance is also among the dead, along with one of the hostages and 4 others who police say had no identification papers. Another person, believed to be one of the owners of the bed and breakfast establishment, is still unaccounted for. It seems certain that one outcome of the Port Arthur tragedy will be swift moves to make gun laws uniformly stricter across the nation. Particularly targeted will be military-style high-powered automatic weapons, such as those used by the Port Arthur killer.
There is no legitimate interest served, in my view, by the free availability in this country of weapons of this kind.
The Prime Minister backed his stand with action. As a matter of urgency, he's brought forward a meeting of state and federal police ministers to implement uniform national gun laws. And although Canberra has no specific powers to bring in federal controls, Mr. Howard has vowed to use all his political clout to finally get action on this contentious issue.
I will not retreat an inch from the national responsibilities I have in relation to this whole issue. Not an inch.
Other gun critics want to go even further than just controlling one sector of the weapons market.
There is absolutely no right to bear arms in the community. There is a right to community safety, and we're seeing that right to safety completely disregarded while politicians cower in fear of what the gun lobby can do to their electoral hopes.
First reaction to these moves shows that the states look set to fall into line this time in a positive move to make events like Port Arthur more difficult to occur in the future. Malcolm Weatherup, 7 News.
News of the Port Arthur tragedy has swamped the British media and caused fears of a tourism backlash. But experts say British sympathy is with Australia and any fall in tourist figures will be short-lived.
Only a month after the tragedy of Dunblane, and the British were reeling in horror with news of Port Arthur.
It was the worst gun massacre ever.
Saturation coverage here, but is this and the intense interest in the backpacker serial murders destroying Australia's image as the dream destination? British tourism experts say any drop-off will only be temporary.
It's understandable that for maybe 48 hours, maybe even a week, after a tragic incident like Dunblane or the incident in Tasmania, people will, out of sympathy, just simply decide not to travel to that place.
Also, the Australian Tourism Commission took the step of issuing a statement to Britain's media today, saying Australia was still a safe and secure place to visit. But there were signs of nervousness. This Tasmanian tourism campaign ran in the weekend press out of respect. It was quickly abandoned today, but the press coverage certainly didn't slow down.
Tonight, terror in Tasmania. After Dunblane, another lone gunman, another mass murder of the innocent.
Talkback TV and newspaper debates, all from a country that knows better than any other what Australia is going through. In London, Chris Reason, 7 News.
No words can express the horror and disbelief in this little Tasmanian tourist centre tonight. Port Arthur has become a town of crisis, of wounded crowded into hospitals, of police desperately trying to piece the massacre together, and of families shattered by tragedy.
Yes, less than 36 hours after the gunman went on an indiscriminate rampage, the death toll stands at 35. The worst massacre by a single civilian in world history. The killer himself is in hospital with some of his victims. He was captured, his clothes ablaze, as he ran from a burning building.
The horrific massacre at the historic penal settlement began without warning.
Hit the gunshots.
Having murdered 32 unsuspecting local residents and tourists, the snipers stopped at a bed and breakfast lodge 5 kilometres north of the convict settlement and took 3 hostages, a couple in their 70s and a man who was earlier forced into the boot of a BMW and driven to the guest house. That car was later gutted by fire. Inside the seascape lodge, the man, armed with several high-powered rifles, continued firing at police, who were trying to negotiate by phone.
Our principle at the moment is to keep the house isolated and the people in it contained within the site. And we're hoping to open negotiations again. They've broken down because of some technical problems. A battery, I understand, and a phone that he had in the house ran out.
Has power to the house.
It's as simple as that.
Victorian Special Operations Group police flew in to surround the house where they lay in wait until dawn.
That's a pretty horrific sight for my people in there at the moment. It'll take quite some time to work through this, so I just hope you bear with us and give us a little bit of room to move.
What about the number of injured?
What's the chance of the death toll getting much higher than what it already is?
Well, it's very difficult to say. It's dark in there at the moment, and as I said, my people are trying to work through the site and locate anybody that has been killed other than the ones we've already found.
Then, at 8 this morning, police were taken aback when they saw the Seascape Lodge burst into flames.
The upstairs portion of it is on fire, and there are flames coming from partly down the on the lower level, on part of it. It's starting to slowly spread, I understand. There are still shots being fired, so at this stage I've given instructions that none of our personnel are to approach the house.
30 minutes after the fire began, the gunman himself walked out of the cottage, his own clothes on fire. He was immediately arrested by heavily armed Special Operations Police.
A person has been taken into police custody, conveyed to the Royal Albert Hospital, suffering from burns, no gunshot wounds.
The killer was taken by ambulance to a Hobart hospital. Under police guard, his head covered. He was wheeled into casualty and will face court as soon as his doctors allow. For 2 hours today, police escorted us to see the results of the killer's rampage. The house where his 3 hostages died was still smouldering. Having arrested the gunman, aged in his late 20s, police soon realised there were no survivors in the house. It burnt to the ground, leaving only the chimney and iron veranda post standing. The 3 hostages who died inside the cottage take the unbelievable death toll to 35, Australia's worst shooting massacre.
I think carnage is the simple way to describe it. It's probably the only single word that I know that would describe what was experienced in there.
The tourist region will reopen to the public in the next few days. The sudden and appalling slaughter now added to the region's already dark history. At Port Arthur, Dean Allen Craig, 7 Nightly News.
This afternoon, news cameras were allowed back into the convict ruins to follow the trail of tragedy left by the gunman. Darren Linton joined the convoy through the Port Arthur killing fields.
The lone gunman, armed with a high-powered semi-automatic rifle, opened fire first at a restaurant in the heart of the picturesque Port Arthur penal colony.
He hit the gunshots.
20 people died during the first terrifying minutes. Some didn't even flee, thinking the shots were part of the Sunday afternoon show.
We thought the site must have been had a reenactment of some kind. We weren't told about it, but we usually were always told about it, so.
Police are still formally identifying the bodies in the restaurant, and they will remain at the scene until later tonight.
In a number of locations, it could be best described as 3 predominant locations within the restaurant.
Some still at tables? How would you describe
it? Yes, there were some still at tables, appearing as though they were still eating their meal.
The rampage continued as the gunman set his sights on a bus nearby. He shot a passenger through the front window and 3 other people standing outside.
It's not make-believe, it's real. I've seen bodies.
It was here as the gunman drove out of the park that he shot dead a mother and her 2 children, sisters aged 3 and 6.
Police came across the body of a woman and her 3-year-old daughter lying on the roadway, and the body of the 6-year-old daughter was behind the tree. It's our understanding that the mother was carrying the three-year-old baby when they were both shot, and the six-year-old ran away trying to escape and was shot in the process.
The children's father later arrived distraught at the police command post. By now, police and other emergency services were on their way to the scene, treating the many wounded as best they could and trying to limit the carnage.
It's horrendous, catastrophic. It's just beyond even thinking about, particularly anywhere, not let alone Tasmania.
But more blood would be spilled. At the toll gate marking the entrance to the park, bloodied blankets mark the spots where four men died, apparently shot for their BMW, after the gunman abandoned his yellow Volvo on the side of the road.
Everyone's just devastated.
I suppose everyone has lost a friend, I suppose, in this.
Everyone knows everyone in the picture.
By now, police had begun evacuating the area, including this crowded restaurant 10 minutes away.
Well, we had a call about 2:30 saying that there was a gunman going rampage and had shot, at that stage, 25 people who was coming our way, and for us to stay away from our windows and to be aware of what was happening. So we actually had to call our 30 people we had in the restaurant at that stage, let them know what was happening, and most of them rushed upstairs into the house and in terrible fright, and up the back into the bushes. It was quite a horrific experience.
One more person would die. In Port Arthur, a woman leaving the general store shot through the front windscreen of her car. The 29-year-old gunman then drove to the seascape bed and breakfast to play out the final chapter in his grisly saga. In a few short minutes, he'd left behind 32 dead and 16 wounded, even pausing to fire on helicopters attempting to rescue the injured. Making it harder to accept the carnage is the fact that there is still no motive, no inkling as to why the gunman visited this horror on a quiet Tasmanian community. In Port Arthur, Darren Linton for 7 Nightly News.
As you saw in that story, Superintendent Jack Johnson is in charge of police operations. David Johnson spoke to him a short time ago.
It's not quite finished for us yet. So far, we're quite content with the result, of course. But unfortunately, it's a very nasty event by whatever measure you apply to it.
But the operation, from your point of view, went well?
Oh, yes. We've been able to resolve the issues quite satisfactorily.
Now, when you arrived at the scene here, I understand that you described the scene in the tea rooms as something like war.
I was very perturbed when I went into those facilities down there in the restaurant, because whilst I haven't seen a war zone, that's what I've seen on the television and depicted in other arenas as being a war zone.
And some of the people were killed while they were sitting there eating?
And they appeared to have been taken completely by surprise. Slumped over beside their meals.
Must have been a shocking scene for you.
It was quite horrific.
And what about your members? I mean, are they in shock now as well?
A lot of people have been very grossly affected by a number of the scenes at this particular incident, and we're going to great lengths to ensure that everybody is provided with as much support, debriefing and counselling as we can possibly provide.
As residents of Port Arthur relive the massacre, some remarkable stories are emerging. Their tales of bloodshed and lucky escapes, and of astonishing acts of bravery.
With the dead outnumbering the survivors 2-1, there aren't many who can tell police exactly what happened at Port Arthur yesterday. Those who can have told of how they'll be haunted by their narrow escapes. Hobart woman Karen Jones said tourists thought the sound of gunfire was part of some historic reenactment at the infamous penal settlement.
It was just like a cannon going off. We thought it was all part of the show. We were going down to check out what was going on, you know. Thought it might have been a little bit of extra on the side. So like, you get the tours around there, and we thought, well, they were letting off cannons and...
Her boyfriend, Philip Milburn, says the shooting was not as random as initially reported.
I mean, if we walked past him and we went the other way and he went to the shop, I think, well, if he got out of the car and started shooting straight away, we might have been the first, maybe.
The shock of their encounter with the gunman was still setting in today as they recounted the panic of the scramble to safety.
A pregnant lady, Karen, she was there. She just couldn't stop vomiting. She was sort of panicky. There was an old guy upstairs. He'd lost his wife. He couldn't find her, but they found her downstairs.
He just asked because he couldn't get downstairs. Too many people, and everyone sort of passed the message on. They found her.
So there would have been people in there who may have lost loved ones who didn't know what had happened to their loved ones.
Among the others facing danger, helicopter pilots forced to fly through gunfire during the airlift of casualties.
Well, I was requested by the paramedic to fly as low as possible, which is not an unusual situation as we normally get involved in that type of accident or in people with chest injuries. We are used to that, and sometimes, luckily yesterday, the weather was not a problem, so we were able to comply with that request and we came all the way below 1,000 feet.
At least five of the survivors who crossed the gunman's path are yet to tell their stories. They remain in a critical condition here at Royal Hobart Hospital, but doctors are confident they will pull through.
I mean, the seriously ill, are being monitored constantly, and we are hopeful, that over the next sort of 48 hours or so, that their results will be good.
Of the 13 others wounded, 11 are described as satisfactory and two have been released.
We have a plan here, which is called a Code Brown. It's an emergency plan that was put in action and in place in 45 minutes. The overall performance of all staff, from the medical staff to the coding staff, have been brilliant.
Hospital staff have been praised for the way they coped with the emergency, management denying rumours that some nurses refused to treat the gunman. Adam Walters, 7 Nightly News.
While pictures of the rampage have gone around the world, details of the killer remain sketchy. He's known to be intellectually handicapped, in his late 20s, and unlicensed to carry a gun, let alone a lethal automatic rifle.
We honestly thought that maybe half-jokingly we said we'll be lucky to get out of this one alive, and that's honestly what we thought. But in the back of your mind you say it as a joke, but there was meaning behind it, and apparently I was right.
A chilling encounter with an alleged mass murderer. Gary Sprigg will never forget the painting work he did on the alleged Tasmanian gunman's home last year.
And the things he was saying about me and the things that I could hear that going on in the house, and I just knew things weren't right.
Could you hear the gunfire?
Mm-hmm. It was just like a cannon going off. We thought it was all part of the show.
Karen Jones and de facto husband Philip Milburn could have been the gunman's first victims. He arrived at Port Arthur as they prepared to tour the nearby ruins. They were just metres apart.
Do you think you were lucky?
Yep, I do.
if we walked past him and we went the other way and he went to the shop, I think, if he got out of the car and started shooting straight away, we might have been the first, maybe.
So who is this man behind Australia's worst massacre? He lived in this quiet street. Neighbours unaware the man said to be either mentally unbalanced or schizophrenic was capable of murder.
I think maybe he was just a very quiet person that kept to himself, yeah.
You never seen him carrying weapons or anything?
No, I never seen anything like that, no.
Did you know that he had guns?
No, I didn't know that either, no. I didn't know he had guns.
So it must be a hell of a shock to you.
It is a shock, yeah. It is a shock. Great shock.
And this is where the alleged killer lived, in this rambling two-storey house, largely hidden by overgrown vegetation, in a modest middle-class suburb in northern Hobart. Neighbours remember the man as being quiet, a loner, seen sometimes walking his dogs. But others have told us they remember him quite differently.
Just that he'd talk about younger children, younger people, in a way that a normal person wouldn't talk. Senses, you just know. It's just that it wasn't right.
The alleged killer remains in Hobart Hospital, but slowly a more detailed picture of the man and his motives is being drawn. For some, this nightmare will never go away.
There is a couple of things that happen down here, but you don't ever think it's going to be as bad as this.
In the wake of the Port Arthur massacre, Prime Minister John Howard has responded instantly to demands for tougher gun laws. The Tasmanian laws have been criticised as being so lax they invite disaster. Mr Howard says he'll push for a national gun register at a crisis meeting of federal and state police ministers to be held on Friday week.
These are the weapons of destruction that are all too easily available in Australia.
The horror of the Port Arthur slaughter has prompted emotional pleas for tighter gun laws to control their use.
There is absolutely no right to bear arms in the community. There is a right to community safety, and we're seeing that right to safety completely disregarded while politicians cower in fear of what the gun lobby can do to their electoral hopes.
Prime Minister John Howard responded immediately, bringing forward a meeting of state and federal police ministers to Friday week to implement uniform national gun laws.
There is no legitimate interest served, in my view, by the free availability in this country of weapons of this kind.
While the federal government banned the import of semi-automatic weapons in 1991, one major stumbling block remains. The Commonwealth does not have the constitutional power to impose national gun laws on the states. But Mr. Howard says this time he won't brook any opposition.
I will not retreat an inch from the national responsibilities I have in relation to this whole issue. Not an inch.
We've got to get it done and get it done in the right way.
And the signs today are that the states will finally fall into line.
I believe that the public of Australia are looking for urgent and immediate reaction.
A national response, a national approach, a national solution is required.
But the gun lobby is continuing to resist.
I have no problem with all the states having the same gun laws. What I do have a problem is with the government in Canberra trying to take control of those things, which are, at the moment, the rights of the sovereign states.
In Canberra, Glenn Mellon, 7 Nightly News.
Welcome back to Sunrise. The Prime Minister and Opposition Leader and Democrats Leader are heading for Port Arthur this morning to pay their respects to the victims of Sunday's massacre. They will join the Governor-General for a memorial service in Hobart later today. But a moving memorial mass was held last night in Hobart. Seven Network correspondent Adam Walters is in Hobart and joins us now live. Adam, what can you tell us about that service last night?
Well, Tasmanians everywhere, Peter, are still grieving the loss of 35 people at Port Arthur on Sunday, and every day since there's been some sort of mass in the Catholic churches or service, multi-denominational. Last night at St Mary's here in Hobart, a very moving mass attended by community leaders and people from throughout this district, including school children, who at one stage during the mass lit a candle for every one of the 35 victims. It was very touching.
Adam, today there has been a great deal of talk already, even so early this morning, about new gun laws in Tasmania. Tasmania has the most lax gun laws in the country. What kind of response has there been to support those new laws?
Overwhelming, Peter. It's unambiguously supported this move by the government here in Tasmania. As we know, before the shooting, this state had what many people considered to be the most lax gun laws in Australia. That's about to change within 10 days. If that's not a government's knee-jerk reaction to this terrible massacre, I don't know what is. With by next Tuesday, I believe the Parliament here will be starting to enact legislation which will prohibit the sale of any military-style semi-automatic weapons.
And that may set the pattern for other state premiers because, as we've already heard earlier this week, Canberra can't impose a national law. All the state premiers have to agree on uniform laws around the country.
That seems to be the case. I mean, John Howard's been very vocal on this. He's been showing tremendous leadership on the issue of gun control from the outset. He's been saying that he'll be encouraging all the state leaders to take his advice. This can't be forgotten, this massacre, and John Howard is going to make sure of that.
And he has the momentum now. Thanks, Adam.
Okay, Peter.
7 News correspondent Adam Walters joining us live from Hobart.
One of the survivors of the massacre has given a chilling first-hand account of the horror of Sunday afternoon. Peter Croswell told how he escaped the gunman in the cafe where the massacre began.
About to eat lunch in Port Arthur's Broad Arrow Cafe, Peter Croswell knew instantly the noise from outside came from a high-powered rifle.
This guy walked in, long blonde hair, and shot dead one guy that was sitting at the nearest table. Then proceeded to shoot everybody at that table.
Mr. Croswell jumped onto the two women he was with, Pamela Law and Thelma Walker, camp quality puppeteers from Sydney. They all lay on the ground, terrified, as the shots kept coming.
He must have seen somebody that was still alive and walked towards that person. He yelled out, "No, no." He then shot him. I could only see two other people alive. Everybody else had horrific head wounds. They were obviously dead.
Without speaking, the gunman reloaded, walked outside, and kept firing.
There wasn't much I could do at all.
He doesn't know why they were spared. He will never return to Port Arthur. Natalie Barr, 7 News.
Flags in the Commonwealth buildings throughout the country will be flown at half-mast today as a mark of national mourning for the victims of the Port Arthur massacre. It comes as grief-stricken friends and relatives try to come to terms with their loss.
Zoe Hall was a 28-year-old Sydney solicitor with everything to live for. She was in Tasmania for a friend's birthday. She was one of the first to be shot down. Salvation Army officer Tony Kiston died in the arms of his wife.
As Tony lay in the arms of his wife, he said, "As a true Christian, I'm going to be with the Lord."
In Victoria at Redcliffs, just outside Mildura, flags flew at half-mast and the streets were nearly deserted.
So very quiet. There was no breeze, no birds, no nothing.
Ron Jari, a retired fruit grower, and Dennis Lever, the local jeweller, died protecting their loved ones.
Ron and Dennis were great blokes, and the whole, none of us can really understand.
Ron Jari's neighbours told of his extraordinary kindness.
A gentle man with a lovely personality who loved life.
Flowers placed near the Jari home and outside the Levers' shopfront spoke eloquently of how their town regarded them. In Melbourne, the family of massacre hero Peter Nash were today stunned by his death. Mr. Nash was gunned down shielding his wife, Carolyn, from a bullet.
Peter knew what was coming and he completely covered her whole body.
Dunstan, a small potato farming community near Ballarat, lost two of its most respected residents. Merv and Mary Howard were shot dead while enjoying a rare holiday. They leave behind 5 children.
The community's reeling from it. It's absolutely devastated. I think that we've lost 2 such fine people as they were.
Merv has been the pillar of football in Ballarat for the last 16 years as chairman of the local board.
Flags at the Kilmore Golf Club were at half-mast, 3 of its members among the first to die inside the Broad Arrow Cafe. 69-year-old Kevin Sharp was shot dead shielding his wife from the hail of bullets. Sadly, his younger brother Raymond and friend Wally Bennett died seconds later.
Mates all their lives, and they unfortunately died together.
In Perth, Premier Richard Court was one of the first to learn that Western Australians had been caught up in the tragedy.
The whole incident is just sickening.
A young woman from the Perth suburb of Balga, 21-year-old Kate Elizabeth Scott, was about to start a new job, her life cut short with a gun blast. Tonight, the scale of the tragedy detailed in the long list of victims. Tracy Horn, 7 News.